Salutations, Celestial Sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Well, over on Stellarium, I have the southern sky set up for the 17th, which is Sunday. And I want to show you where the moon was going to be at then. And the moon moves across the sky from the west towards the east as it revolves around Earth. Now, what you're going to notice happens as I move from the 17th and 18th over into the 19th is that the moon is going to be right near this star, Aldebaran, which is the brightest star in Taurus the Bull. And the bull shape is here. There's one horn. There's the other horn up and to the right of where Orion is. And I will center this, and then we'll zoom right in. And you can see how, at least for me, my location, I'm just south of Chicago. So at around 8 o'clock on Tuesday evening, the moon is going to block Aldebaran. So I go a couple minutes into that, and boom, the moon actually blocks this first magnitude star. What I would encourage you to do is download Stellarium, set it up to your location, and then see what time the moon is going to block it for you, because it will be different depending on what part of North America or Western Europe that you're in as to what time and where it's going to actually appear when it does block this star. That in and of itself is interesting, and I think it's a great thing to be able to witness, but it's only going to happen for a couple minutes, and it only happens on Tuesday. So we can look at some of the features that are on the moon that evening. You'll notice we have this lovely look at the moon here. Mare Imbrium is in the northern part of the moon. For a refractor, that's going to still appear in the northern part. It'll appear up. For a reflector, that's going to be reversed. But both a refractor and a reflector are going to reverse the image left to right. So just be aware of that. And the way that you can know that for sure is you'll be able to see this kind of cut out of Mare Imbrium. It's made by this feature called Sinus Iridum. And it is actually kind of flanked by these mountains called Montes Jura. Now, what I do want to point out is there's this really cool little tiny crater right along these mountains that is called Bianchini. So do use some additional magnification and try and zoom in on that a little bit if you can. One of the major features that you certainly won't be able to miss is Copernicus. It's a very large crater. It's about 100 kilometers across, so easy to see, and you can actually see a lot of the crater rays that have appeared on the surface of the moon as a result of this being one of the younger craters. A little bit to the west of there is Montes Carpatus. That's a mountain range, and the further towards the terminator, that line where the shadow of the moon is from sunlight, the more shadows you'll see and the more 3D the features will appear to be on the moon's surface. Towards the south, we have Mare Nubium. Within that, there's an interesting crater called Bulialdis, and there's actually a little mountain in the center of that. It's actually due to the way that the crater was created, but that is going to be interesting to see, and I will have this particular graphic that has a bunch more features listed on it on eyesonthesky.com, so you can definitely check that out and see a number of these interesting things. Do also look over on the non-shadowed side of the moon. Mare Marginis and Mare Smithi are visible right now because the moon has the libration of the moon has actually turned it a little bit, so we can sort of peek around the edge, so you'll be able to see those Mare for a good portion of this week, even if you don't get to see it on Tuesday based on clouds. One thing I want to mention quickly is a little bit about light pollution. I have these products, and these are called PAR shields. PAR shields are actually they're just a simple shield that can go over top of a typical flood lamp. They do actually also work on some of the newer LED lamps. If you go to parshield.com, they tell you some of the specific ones that these do fit onto. Some of the newer LED lamps. Not all of them will fit this easily, but older flood lamps, this works quite easily. It does a great job of directing light down and keeps it from messing up your neighbor's sleep while you have floodlights on, if you have to turn them on while it's dark. As we turn our attention over towards the northern part of the sky, you'll notice that there is a comet that it's making its way up from the horizon. It's sort of been a little bit more on the morning side of things, but it's now really going to become a fairly good evening object. At the moment, it is over by the handles, the bent handle star of the Big Dipper, Alcor Mizar. However, we're going to have the moon that's going to really interfere with it for a decent part of the next week or so, as the moon goes from first quarter phase into full phase by the 24th. However, this comet is actually going to go up through Draco and above Polaris of the Little Dipper. So we're actually going to go ahead and move this ahead to about 11 o'clock at night. So that brings the comet and the Big Dipper kind of rising up. We're about 25 degrees up from the horizon if we're looking from my latitude of about 40 degrees north latitude. Now watch what happens when I move this over the next several days as we go through into where the full moon is on the 24th. You can see how the comet goes through Draco. It's not too far from Kappa Draconis on the 23rd, and on the 24th it moves a little bit away from it. Again, we're still full moon there, but now we're starting to lose the moon in the evening hours. So by the 26th, 27th, we can see that this comet is actually going to be moving towards this fourth magnitude star right near, not too far from where Polaris is. I believe that's about 7 degrees away. So if we pull that in, we can see it's about 8 degrees. So a little bit more than a finder scope or binoculars field of view, but it's going to be the brightest star there. So you can find that fairly easily because it's going to be pretty much the brightest star in that region. And plus the comet is 6 magnitude. So even though it's spread out and faint, you should be able to see it with fairly small telescopes, 80 millimeters. And particularly as you have larger telescopes, the better it's going to look, obviously. The nice thing about this part of the sky, there's really not a lot of deep sky objects. It's kind of deep sky objects poor. And what is there tends to be a lot of really faint galaxies of 10th or 11th magnitude or dimmer. So you're not going to confuse a 6th magnitude comet with a 10th magnitude galaxy by any means. So that's going to kind of cruise over into the dim constellation Camelopardalis into the early part of February, even though the comet does start to fade by then. It'll probably be fading off from 6th magnitude into 7th magnitude by mid-February. But that gives us a number of weeks to be able to look at this comet. I have links for you to be able to follow that comet if you want to print off a piece of paper, or you can use Stellarium. You can actually download that using the configuration window function. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes in the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.